Hello everyone, today we discuss about the bone clavicle. Now first of all you should know that whatever bone given in your exam is of which side. So first of all, very important side determination of the clavicle bone. First of all, the lateral end of the clavicle is flat and the medial end is large and quadrilateral, as you can see. Okay, next, the shaft of the clavicle is basically slightly curved so that it is convex forwards in its medial two-third area and concave forwards in its lateral one-third area. Remember, medial two-third convex forwards and lateral one-third concave forwards. Okay, and also the inferior surface of the clavicle is grooved longitudinally in its middle one-third area. Now next are the peculiarities of the clavicle bone. Now the clavicle bone is basically the only long bone in the body that lies horizontally. Rest all the long bones are vertically placed except the clavicle bone. Now also the clavicle is subcutaneous throughout its nature. Also it is the first bone to start ossify in your body. Also it is the only long bone which ossifies in the membrane. Rest all the bone actually ossifies in the cartilage. Okay, while the clavicle in the membrane. Now it is the only long bone which has two primary centers of ossification, rest have only one. There is no medullary cavity present in the clavicle, and also it is occasionally pierced by the middle supraclavicular nerve. Now remember, this clavicle basically receives the width of the upper limb, okay, of the upper limb by the lateral one third through the coracoclavicular ligament and transmit the weight of the upper limb to the axial skeleton by the medial two-third of the part of the clavicle bone. Okay, now next is the features of the clavicle bone. Now first of all, the shaft of it. The shaft, of course, told you before, only actually divided into the lateral one-third and the medial two-third part. Remember, the lateral one-third part of the clavicle is actually concave forward, while the medial two-third part is actually convex forward. Now first of all, the lateral one-third part. Now this part is basically flattened from above downwards and it has basically two borders, that is the anterior and the posterior borders. Now the anterior border is basically concave forwards, I told you before only, right? And the posterior border is convex backward, of course. Now this part of the bone has two surfaces, remember, the superior and the inferior surfaces. Now first of all, the superior surface. Now the superior surface is basically subcutaneous and the inferior surface presents an elevation known as the conoid. Tubercle. Okay, remember, at the inferior surface there is one elevation known as the conoid tubercle, and also a ridge is present over there known as the trapezoid ridge. So remember two things: conoid tubercle and a ridge known as the trapezoid ridge. Now next is the medial two-third part of the shaft. Now this medial two-third part of the shaft is basically rounded and is said to have four surfaces, that is the anterior surface, posterior surface, superior and the inferior surface. Now first of all, the anterior surface. The anterior surface is basically convex forwards. The posterior one is smooth. The superior surface is actually rough in its medial part and the inferior surface has a rough oval impression at the medial end of it. The lateral half of this surface means the medial part only, but the lateral part of this medial two-third has a longitudinal subclavian groove, as you can see in the diagram. Okay. Now the nutrient foramen basically lies at the lateral end of the subclavian groove. Now next is the lateral and the medial ends of the clavicle bone. Now first of all, the lateral end. The lateral end of the clavicle bone is also known as the acromial end, and this acromial end is actually flattened from above downwards. It bears a facet that articulates with the acromion process of the scapula to form the acromioclavicular joint. Remember, there is one facet known as the that facet is basically for the acromion process of the scapula, and this facet, or we can say the acromial facet of the clavicle bone at the lateral part or the lateral end, actually forms the acromioclavicular joint along forming a joint with the scapula. Okay, and the acromion process of the scapula. Now next is the medial end. The medial end is also known as sternal end because this end will actually have some kind of attachment with the sternum bone. Simple. The medial or the sternal end is actually quadrangular in structure and articulates with the clavicular notch of the manubrium sterni to form the sternoclavicular joint. So lateral end will actually form the acromioclavicular joint, while the medial end of the clavicle will actually form the sternoclavicular joint. Now the articular surface basically end extends to the inferior aspect for articulation with the first costal cartilage also. Okay, now next is about the attachments at the of the clavicle bone. Now remember first of all, at the lateral end, the margin of the articular surface for its acromioclavicular joint gives attachment to the joint capsule. Of course, at the lateral end, there will form the acromioclavicular joint. So of course, there will be a joint capsule present over here at the lateral end, okay, of the clavicle. Now next is the medial end. At the medial end, the margin of the articular surface for the sternum gives attachment to basically three main structures, okay. First of all, fibrous capsule of the sternoclavicular joint all around, then articular disc posterosuperiorly and interclavicular ligament superiorly. Remember, at the medial end, if you remember, there was formation of the sternoclavicular joint, okay. So because sternoclavicular joint present over here, there will be related structure of the particular joint, that is the fibrous capsule, articular disc and the interclavicular ligament. Now next is the lateral one third of the shaft. Now this lateral one third basically gives attachment to three main structure. First of all, remember, the anterior border of the lateral one third gives origin to the deltoid muscle. As you can see, deltoid muscle from the anterior border of the lateral one third of the shaft. Now next is the at the posterior border, there is insertion of the trapezius muscle. So anterior border deltoid muscle and the posterior border trapezius muscle. And also remember, the conoid tubercle and the trapezoid ridge over here gives attachment to the conoid and the trapezoid parts of the coracoclavicular ligament. Okay. Now next is the medial two-third of the shaft. Now over here, remember, most of the anterior surface gives origin to the pectoralis major muscle. Okay, remember, the anterior surface, most of the anterior surface, pectoralis major muscle. Now next is the half of the rough superior surface. Okay, if you remember, we have four surfaces of the medial two-third. Okay, and in that, the superior part was the roughened part. So remember, the half of the rough superior surface gives origin to the clavicular head of the sternocleidomastoid, SCM muscle, sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now also, the oval impression on the inferior surface of the medial end gives attachment to the costoclavicular ligament. Also, the subclavian groove over here, if you remember, on the lateral part of the medial two-third area of the clavicle, there was one groove known as subclavian groove. Now over here, in the subclavian groove, of course, there will be attachment of the subclavius muscle. Now the margins of the subclavian grooves gives attachment to the clavipectoral fascia also. Now, the posterior surface actually close to the medial end gives origin to the sternohyoid muscle. Okay. Also remember, the subclavian vessels and the cords of the brachial plexus passes towards the axilla lying between the inferior surface of the clavicle and the upper surface of the first rib. The subclavius muscle basically over here acts as a cushion for the subclavian vessels and the cords of brachial plexus present over here. Now next thing is the applied aspects of the clavicle bone. Now remember, the clavicle is basically fractured by falling on the outstretched hand. And remember, the most common site of the fracture over here is the junction between the two curvatures of the bone, which is the weakest point. Remember, the weakest point over here is the junction between the two ends, two surfaces of the shaft, that is the medial two-third and the lateral one-third. So, in between these two areas, the weakest point or the weakest area of the clavicle basically present, where the chance of the fracture for the clavicle is maximum. Now over here in the diagram, as you can see, the lateral part, the lateral one third over here, the lateral fragment of the clavicle is displaced downwards. Okay, and this is the common thing occurs at the fracture of the in the fracture of the clavicle. The lateral part basically goes downwards. Why? Because of the weight of the limb, as trapezius muscle alone is unable to support the weight of the upper limb. That's why the lateral part, actually the lateral one third of the clavicle will fall downward. Okay. Now next is the cleidocranial dysostosis. Now what happens in the cleidocranial dysostosis? The clavicle may be congenitally absent or imperfectly developed in the disease known as the cleidocranial dysostosis. And in this condition, the shoulder droops and can be approximated anteriorly in front of the chest, as you can see in this figure. Okay. So this is all about the clavicle bone. I hope you understood well. Thank you so much.